Hey, what up, Q? What up, Radio World?
Think about it. Think about it. Think about it.
My name is Quincy. And this is my show, the T2Q radio show. Caller, go ahead.
Hey, Q, how are you?
What up, what up?
Let me thank you for having me on your show. It's so awesome to be here with you and all your listeners.
Batman posted some in the chat room that almost made me choke over here. My man Ray out there in New Jersey. Ray, what's going on, man?
Hey, what's up, man? How you doing?
No, I ain't telling you don't screw. Screwing's cool.
Some women are down for it.
Wow.
I said some, not all.
This is a show that people are supposed to get their opinion and tell what they think.
And I think it's offensive to say that a person who speaks well is trying to speak white.
Well, I am pro-woman, but I'm not anti-man. I know the value of a good man.
Is that what's going on, people? All right. I want to welcome you to a special exclusive edition of the T2Q radio show. My name is Quincy, and this is my show. And this is year 10 of the T2Q radio show, the show's 10th birthday. I started the show back in February 20th, 2011. It's kind of a bucket list item. I just wanted to do something since I had the opportunity to. Anybody could have a podcast or a talk show if they simply took the time to do the research and sign up and give it a try. And I did it. And before I got ready to cross it off my bucket list after doing my first 15-minute episode, which was horrible, I had a couple of people come to me, a couple of my peers, and they said, hey, I want to be on your show. And I said, really? And they're like, yeah. I said, what are we going to talk about? They're like, I don't know. So I brought them on, two ladies, Fallon out of Houston and Lynn out of Michigan. And I'm out of Detroit, and brought them on. We had a good time, laughed, giggled, cut up, and I decided to keep going. And from there, my cousin Worm joined the show, and me and Worm would talk. And then after a while, a couple of his friends joined, Willie Ace, Laura. I can't remember all the names from back in the day. And so they joined the show. And then one day I was on the air, I want to say in May of 2011, and Eminem called in. And I had told Eminem, you know, we were working together at the time. I had told him about the show, and he didn't really understand that it was my show. I guess he just thought I was talking about something in general. So I guess he got curious and called in one day. And then he was like, oh, man, this is right up my alley, you know. And so me and him kind of kicked it for a while. And sometimes it was just me and him. We would talk for 30 minutes, then I would throw out questions, and he would give his response, and it was great. And then he told Ray, and, you know, Ray became a part of the show, and then Buck got in the mix, and Buck became a part of the show. And so it was like those were my original three show legends, like the three musketeers, so to speak. And we did the little thing, and then all of a sudden, here comes Crystal, okay? And so Crystal calls in, and she mixed it up with the guys, and everyone referred to her as their, you know, as a man eater, so to speak. And she didn't back down. And I was like, OK, I'm really enjoying the contrast I have between the personalities, especially with her and Ray, because her and Ray will always go at each other. And so Crystal stuck around and she became an integral part of the show. And so now I have my first female show legend. I'm like, OK, all right, this thing is really rolling, and kind of built that momentum over the years. And so I really just wanted to bring some of the original show legends on just to talk with them and just talk about the last 10 years. Nothing necessarily specific, not going to take too much of anyone's time. So, well, you know, since they are show legends, then we got to do show legend introductions, right? From the 732 area code, the Garden State of New Jersey, please welcome on the show enforcer, Ray. Ray, what's going on, man? You're on mute, Ray. What's happening?
Oh, what's up, man? You had went out for a minute. Everything all right? Okay. Man?
All right. Glad to have you on.
All right. Did you send Amanda the link? She sent you a text.
I hadn't seen the text yet, but I will get that link to her in just a moment. Let me go ahead and introduce another show legend, and I'll try to inbox that link to her on Facebook.
All right.
From the 248 area code, the outskirts of the Motor City of Detroit, please welcome on the author, the show hostess, the show legend, Miss Crystal Hickerson. Chris, what's going on today?
Hey, Q, how are you?
Hey, how's it going?
What's up? What's up, Ray?
How you doing, Chris?
All right. Back to the phone lines I go.
From the 601 area code, my hometown of Jackson, Mississippi, let me welcome on the man, the myth, the original show legend, the Minister of Sexual Affairs, Eminem was shaking.
Hey, well, Q, what up, Radio World? You're number 10, golly, boy.
I know, right? Hard to believe, man. I'm still in this thing.
Right. Yeah. Full decade.
Right.
I say duck egg, but decade.
All right. Let me go back to the virtual studio.
From the 850 area code, the Emerald Coastline of Pensacola, Florida, making his way to the ring, the man in black, the Buckster. Buck, what's going on, bro?
Sound jamming.
Hey, it's all about year 10 and beyond. That's what's up. Not everybody doing
you know it. Everyone's doing well, man, doing well. And so...
Muscles.
That's right.
Oh, man. All right, folks. So 10 years. I mean, there's no script to this show or anything. We just kind of just talking. And I will go to Eminem first. Eminem, with you being the original show legend, man, just talk about your experience, man. Like how you came to the show and just, you know, what it's meant to you over the last 10 years.
Well, of course, you kind of explained a little bit in the beginning, but man, you know, for those people don't know, me and Q worked together one time, and you know, he kept telling me about the show, but I guess I was interpreting it as like, you know, Q's a huge sports fanatic, you know, so I'm thinking like, okay, sports talk Mississippi or something like that, but you know, maybe they might get off topic a little bit, so I really just kind of, not even gonna say brush it off, but I guess I was hearing it, but I wasn't hearing it. And then when he was like, he said it again. He said, nah, like, you know, it's like my show, like I'm the host. So I'm still not thinking that it's his show, but I'm sitting up here like, okay, well, if you hosting, then I'm going to come on. And man, when I got on that thing and and I could hear myself talk, man, that, so you understand, that's, with me, that's vanity to the third power. You know what I'm saying? That's how I get my power, from hearing myself. But it don't sound right if you're talking to yourself at home. That shit is crazy when you're doing it at home. But when you talk to somebody else, you know what I'm saying? Then you can, you know, them thoughts and ideas marinate. So it blossomed from there. And of course, when I brought my cousin on board, it was just like, that was a way that, you know, even though we ain't necessarily talking directly, but it seemed like we talking directly because, you know, he's like, hey, we just, what do we talk about anyway? So that was cool. And then meeting his best pal, Buck. And then of course, man, much love for the lovely Miss Crystal, you know what I'm saying? She introduced the world to a real pimp, you know what I'm saying? Former. But you know, so that, but the show, man, you know, that, like I say, you know, like I said on the fifth year anniversary show and the show number 750 we did, man, this is like so therapeutic for me, because like I say, this show here is like for me personally, this is like a fabric, man. It's like you putting together a quilt of different events, not necessarily in your life personally, but pretty much the events of like your own little timeline, you know, because everything we talk about,
Yeah.
Pretty much the stuff relevant to today's time in some shape, form, or fashion. You know, regardless of how the topics may flow. So, man, this I don't know what I would do without this show, really, because, man, like I said years ago, man, this is like a stage for me. Like, some people get all whatever over this Hollywood stuff. For me, I'm totally different. I'm an independent guy, man. I'm saying, like, if I got that true starve to ghetto mentality. It's like, man, then to be introduced as the original show legend, well, I'm going to get that shit in Hollywood, man. You know, them white boys cool, but they don't do it like this here. So this my thing right here, you know. So.
Okay. All right. Well, but what about you, man? I mean, you know, I remember I told you about the show and then you called in. I mean, what was it like when you first called in? I mean, what was your reaction and how has it helped you or how do you feel about it over the last decade?
You know, when you came to me originally about the show, I was going through my divorce at that time and, you know, just getting everything settled and things of that nature and trying to get used to the new life, you know, not being married. So I was like, I don't know about coming on right, you know, right at first. And then you came back to me about it and you're like, man, you really need to join the show. That, like, I can't let my boy down because, you know, we had done many years ago, we had done a racing, not really a podcast.
Website.
Just, you know, website called 43cars.com. Yeah. We had a lot of fun doing that. And I was like, I said, man, I know this is going to be fun. I said, this will probably help me. It'll be therapeutic. You know, it'll get my mind off of, you know, what I was dealing with at the time. I said, let's do it, you know. And, you know, Eminem and Ray had already joined at that time. And I think the first time I had joined was when we were doing a sports show. And even though I never met Ray or Eminem, it was like when we did that first sports show. And I was like, man, I called Q afterward. I'm like, man, I said, I don't know these other two dudes, but I was like, it was like magic. I'm going like, if it's magic just doing sport, I'm saying to myself, I'm going like, I know it's going to be magic doing one of these other, doing, you know, regular shows. I said, man, this is going to be pretty fun. I said, I'm going to enjoy this. So, you know, coming on to the show and doing the shows, and I think my first regular show was actually, Let's Talk About Sex 3, I think was my first show. I'm not sure. I can't remember.
Okay. Okay. That was summer 2011.
Yeah. So we had, man, the show has been nothing short of amazing because of all the people and all the guests and all the legends that have joined since. I guess you call us the Three Amigos. You know, it's been a really fun ride. And to be able to do this and meet the people that I've, you know, been able to be in contact with, it's been nothing short of amazing. I mean, I know listeners out there, whether they be in the United States or abroad, have learned something from us. Even though we do it in a fun type format where we all have fun, sometimes, you know, we have arguments. Sometimes we're real passionate about certain things. We all bring it back in at the end and, you know, still show that love and passion for one another. Still may be a little hot under the collar, but it's still fun. So, I've enjoyed it, man, and looking forward to many more.
Most definitely, man. Most definitely. And let me go back to the virtual phone lines and welcome on another show legend.
From the 732 area code, the Garden State of New Jersey, please welcome on the voice of reason, Amanda, to the Talk to Q radio show. Amanda, how's it going?
Oops. Hey, Bob, Crystal, hey. Eminem. Ray, how's everybody tonight?
Hey, doing man, well. Man. What's going on?
Good. How you doing?
And so glad to hear you. Now, Amanda, I'm trying to remember when you came into the mix. I want to say you were in there for year one, maybe towards the fall or the winter of 2011. I don't recall for sure. Do you remember about what time you got on board or how exactly you got on board?
I remember Ray and I learned about your show around the same time, and like we were at a family reunion and Eminem told us about it, but I can't remember when I actually became a regular. It probably, mm-hmm. That makes sense, probably like fall or winter maybe.
Okay. Okay. So just talk about what the show has meant to you over the last 10 years. I mean, you've been along for the entire ride too.
I mean, it's been amazing. It's been something to look forward to and a way for all of us to bond and, you know, really get to know people and make some excellent friendships over the years. It's amazing how most, you know, we haven't really actually met each other completely, but, you know, just the friendships that we formed, it's been exceptional, you know, and it's hard to believe that it's been 10 years, but the time has flown by and it's been a lot of fun. It's a way to discuss topics and, you know, sometimes things get heated, but we're all adults and we all have that mutual respect and love for each other. So it's been great. It's just been a great outlet and a great way to associate and discuss all the topics.
Okay. And now, Crystal, you got into the mix around summer 2011, if I'm not mistaken. Can't remember what episode, probably somewhere in the 40s, if I had to guess, 30s or 40s. And I mean, you've been with the show since, you know, year one, and you're the most resilient person I know for many reasons, but you're the most resilient person I know. You're very insightful. You're very passionate and everything. And it's always been enjoyed. I mean, people either love you or they want to argue with you. There's no in between for the most part. But talk about your experience as far as the show is concerned over the past 10 years.
Well, you know, Q, like I said, I was introduced to the show by a friend and coworker, Robin, who had already known about you. She was on a show of her own. And, you know, she introduced me to her show. And then she said, you know, you would probably like Q's show, because I'm on there as well. So I said, okay, fine. So I listened to both. And when I came on to, of course, I can't remember what number show it is, Q. but I do remember coming on and, you know, relationships was the primary kind of thing. And I was like, oh my God, these guys are dicks. I mean, what the hell? And so I said, well, I got to speak up for all the women who are here, who are not here. I had to pour out some tequila to my women who weren't there. And, you know, just kind of like, we're going to do this, you know, screw it. And yeah, there were heated moments. Of course, me and Ray and others, you know, other guys, you know, who aren't here anymore, who I probably have buried out in my backyard. But, you know, they brought out a lot of, you know, energy from me. And you know, energy that, you know, probably needs some serious clinical counseling about. But, you know, they brought it out. And over the years, I've gotten better. It's like therapy. I've gotten much better over the years when it comes to relationships and how I view them. But the main thing for me, Q, with your show is the friendships of everybody. Like Amanda just said, we all just kind of bonded. And if people were listening, that's great. But I didn't really care about that. Really. I was just talking, having a good time, and I couldn't wait for the next week to talk some more. And it was really helpful to me just on a basic level. So I loved it. I loved the show. I had my own show. Eventually it came out. I had my own show, New Crystal Show with Dre, which was amazing. And Q, you know, you would pop into that show and, you know, help me out and everything, which was great. And, you know, we just all had a good time on whatever shows we were on. And there were so many different people who popped in to your show. And it was, I gravitated, it was funny, I gravitated more to your show than I did to my own show, even though I love my show. But your show was my kind of core show that I just like to listen, and I didn't have to do anything. I just call in and show up, and it was great. Because as you know, Q, producing and all that stuff is just work. So much work. It's stupid. But so when I came to your show, it was like a vacation. I was like, cool, I'm going to chill, you know, with my boys, literally. and, you know, just have a good time. So, I mean, I'm glad to still be here after 10 years and no one's killed me yet. Amazingly enough, Ray.
That's great.
But, you know, no one's, I'm still here. I'm still here, bitches. And it's great. And I love that you still honor me with allowing me to come on. And, you know, and Eminem. I mean, hey, if you guys want to know about Eminem, you still go to my YouTube channel because he's still there. Man. People are still
perspective. Listening. Y'all need to release another one.
I mean, no, yeah. Seriously, people are still listening and you know, people are still commenting. It's so funny. I'm like, really? I'm still listening? And it's, but they are. People are, the more they discover, of course, my show, or they discover Eminem, you know, they just keep listening. And so yeah, so it's cool. But yeah, thank you for having me still. And thank you for my therapy. Love you.
It's Q. Therapy for all of us. it really is. I mean, because I when I think about some of the things that I may have believed 10 years ago, I don't believe some of those things now. I mean, this show has allowed me to grow by hearing the perspectives of others. When I hear some of the things from older shows, 2012, 2013, I'm like, oh man, that's, I really thought that way. Or, I mean, there are things that were a big deal to me then, but they're not a big deal now, you know? And so I think that we've all grown for the most part. But what about the 2-year hiatus? You know, like Buck said, I was still doing the sports show and everything. And that was still a lot of fun. It was easy to do. I can get up out of bed and do a sports show. So that was always fun to do that, because that was kind of like, you know, a guy's night out feel to me. Regardless, I really didn't care if nobody listened to the sports show. It was an opportunity to talk noise with the guys. You know, it was a great time. I enjoy talking to Ray and Eminem and Buck because they look at sports the way I look at sports. You know, it's not just that somebody who watches ESPN once and think they know everything. And but what about the 2 years off? Like Eminem, how did you handle that when I first, you know, announced my retirement, like Michael Jordan, before I came back? You know, it was 2 years where there was no show.
Well, I didn't take it well, but something told me that, man, ain't no way in the hell we not gonna be able to do this no more. So when you brought it back, I was elated, man, you know. But I know, I can't remember. I think we did like a special or something one time. Maybe that wasn't during the 2 years. When didn't we do something like after about 6 months one time?
I don't remember.
Was it on?
I don't recall.
It was like some kind of oddball time. We were just so glad to hear each other's voices because the first 10 minutes of the show was pleasantries of legends and people that frequented the show that called us saying we so glad to hear each other's voice. And I remember that, but I can't remember exactly. You know, I thought that might have been during that hiatus, but I'm not sure. But well, like I said, you can't hold, it's too much energy here. So, you know, you know, it's, people learn too much for it not to be, you know, it's just a perfect little formula, you know. So, I just elated when it came back, you know what I'm saying? Because like I say, I love everybody on here, but shit, I don't love nobody more than myself, and I love hearing myself. So, you know. you know.
Yeah.
You're not supposed to admit that, Eminem. You're supposed to keep that shit to yourself.
And Ray, what about you, man? When the show went away, I mean, well, first of all, Ray, you probably got a chance to sleep at it, go to bed at a decent time at night. Because at one time, I was doing the show at 11 p.m. Eastern. I was starting late before I upgraded to the premium Blog Talk Radio. I wasn't allowed to do prime time hours. I couldn't start till 11 o'clock Eastern. And but after the show went away, man, aside from you getting probably some more sleep, I mean, what did it do for you?
No, I mean, I didn't really like that the show had ended, but you know, it's your show, you know, we just legends on the show, so we had to respect that. But you know, the show fills a void where you can pretty much have an outlet from the shit you want to say at work, but you really can't say it, and you know, and you know, how women you get into disagreements with. I can really unload out here, but you know, you can't say all that at work. You know, you gotta let that go. So it was a void once there was no talk to Q. And you know, I was glad you was able to get it back going. I mean, we had sports shows, of course, but you know, I feel like all the topics that people need to discuss, we were discussing. So, you know, it's one thing to say how you feel about it, or you may talk with a couple of friends or something, but some of the topics we discussed wasn't fit for work, so you couldn't really talk about it at work. So,
yeah,
you know, it's one of the things that, well, you kind of can discuss in your own house or, you know, talk about it, but, you know, some close family or friends or something over the phone, but it's not the same platform. Like, all of us, we've been together for an extremely long time, and, you know, we did lots of shows. I mean, I don't know, you know, I think it's up to 800 or something now, but, you know.
What 912.
It's how many?
912.
And, you know, that may vary for each one of us, but we all well up into the 700, 800, so whatever the case may be. So, mm-hmm. I mean, it's a lot of shows. Like I say, we miss talking to each other and stuff like that. So, I mean, it was different over those 2 years, but I was glad you was able to put it back together, because I miss talking to everybody and giving my opinion. And it's not too many places that you could really have an outlet to just kind of say what you're thinking or give an opinion on something and, you know, and joke and laugh and all that kind of stuff when you need to. So that was a good thing. That's the void that was really left. So that was what I probably missed the most, just talking to everybody.
Yeah, definitely. And so, Crystal, you were one of the first people I reached out to when I said that I was thinking about coming back. And I think I might have inboxed you or something and told you that I was coming back. And when I had that first couple of shows I did, I think were interviews. They were Q-on-ones, because I was just trying to get my feet wet again and get back in the mix. And then I had that first live show, which I think was late February 2020. And so, Crystal, what did it feel like being back? I mean, was it like riding a bike? Did things feel different? What was that like for you?
Yeah, it was like riding a bike, you know, having sex, you know, and all that. But, you know, for you, I always told you that you depended too much on outside people coming in live. And we already had a core of people who were waiting and, you know, in the wings for you to get started again. And you know, sometimes I did take offense to that. I was like, you know, you would email me or, you know, text me or whatever and say, hey, I can't believe no one, you know, no one showed up. It was just us. So I was like, damn, what the fuck? It's just us. What's wrong with that? You know, we got the whole crew here. What's your problem, man? And then, and you're like, no, we got to have more people and all this stuff. And I was like, you know what, dude, just, even if it's just you by yourself, because I remember so many times I did shows just by myself, but you know, I can talk.
Yeah, you were good at it. You're good.
I can talk for an hour, 30, you know, an hour and a half, 2 hours, just ranting my bullshit, you know. So I didn't know what the hell was the problem. I don't need nobody to come home in this motherfucker. I can just do it. And, but I was also like, but we already have people. So what's your problem? So that was my only thing with UQ. I was like, we're good. People will tune in later because it's a podcast. Yeah. And people will tune in when they tune in, you know. And don't even worry about that. But you're always stressed about that. And eventually I just shut up and I was like, and I just said it to myself instead of to you. And so, but I was happy with it. And I was happy that, and you know, just like Ray was saying, it was an outlet. You know, it was a way for us to discuss, because I know you didn't know this. Andre knew this, who, you know, who I brought in from another group that I had, you know, that we had late, you know, before this. before I found you, we would do this on Yahoo, you know, email groups. Who remembers that? Truly. And we would do the same thing, except for we would be typing as opposed to talking. And I, you know, he came in as well and to listen to the show and stuff. And, but the thing about it was, is that that's exactly what we did. It was just us. We were just talking to each other. And yes, I had my haters, some severe haters on the other side. And so I was, by the time I got to you guys, I was like, okay, fine, whatever. And, but yeah, I just loved being able to talk to the same people, and it was great. And that's what I missed. You know, I didn't miss, unlike you, of course, you were trying to build your show, but I didn't miss people calling in. I didn't care. As long as we had our legends, I was good. And I'm still good, you know, with just us talking. And hopefully people will tune in, you know, during and after or whatever, and get our feedback and learn from it. But yeah, I was always good about it. So yes, I was very happy when you decided to finally come back. But during the time you were off, I was like, okay, he has to deal with this. He has to do this whole ego thing. But I'm glad you got over that and you came back.
Yeah, it kind of took the time off, I guess, for me to realize that it wasn't really about the numbers. I did get obsessed with the numbers. I wanted the live stats. You know, I wanted the you know, hundreds of people listening live. I wanted the, you know, 500 downloads the next day. And things of that.
Harriet Tubman show and the Virginia Prince show, man.
Right.
That's how we became legends. I mean, that was some classic, instant classic.
And so that stuff drove me a little too much. And I was working like 30 hours a week. I was just really grinding for the show. And the show was doing well because of it. But I got burned out. And then when I restarted, I wasn't sure, like, okay, this is going to be like an interview show, or how am I going to do it? Am I going to still do the live show? And so ultimately, when I realized that the live stuff wasn't important, that allowed me to get away from Blog Talk Radio and move over to where I am now. And then it's kind of like an invite only type of deal. And so I got involved with a bunch of other podcasters, and I was kind of like doing the mentor role for them. And like, you know, with Kaya, who's been on the recent show, or Erica Warren, or people like that. And so I was mixing it up with them, and I've been on a bunch of their shows. I've done a bunch of other shows. I've probably been a guest on more shows last year than I have over my previous 9 years. And so then I was like, well, I got to get back to basics. So, you know, we did the shows on politics, which we always mixed it up. We did current events and things of that nature. But I really wanted to get back to relationships. I wanted to get back to my wheelhouse. And I said, okay, if I'm going to do that, make this show fun again, then I got to incorporate my show legends and get them involved and things of that nature. So I'm still kind of evolving, and I want to find a way, now that I'm doing video with Facebook Live and stuff like that, to make sure that you all are a part of it. And so I'm just trying to brainstorm and figure out the best way of doing that. But I also wanted to do tonight's show because, you know, I said, well, let me get these folks in, get my show legends in. And I really just want my original show legends. I mean, there's some old, you know, I mean, I'm cool with Dr. Willis. I'm cool with Amy and, you know, and Robin and Erica from Cocktails and Conversation, all of them, True Speech. But I really just wanted my old heads in here to kind of mix it up a little bit to show my appreciation. And Amanda, I know you don't get an opportunity to join the show like you used to, but it's always appreciated when you come on and everything. And, you know, maybe if I learn more about your schedule, I can incorporate you going forward if you're still looking to get in every now and then.
Oh, yeah, for sure. You know, it's just with the pandemic, it's like the beginning of the week tends to be crazier for me. But yeah, I can definitely try to do better to make the shows. I hate coming in late, and then it's like, all right, what did I miss? And yeah, but I'm always thinking about you guys, and Ray always tells me kind of when I do miss, hey, this was the topic, or this is what we talked about, or sometimes I can kind of pick up on what he's talking about on this end. But you know, you guys are, you know, all you guys are family. So it's always good for us to be able to get together.
Definitely. And I will probably be doing more shows because I don't really have a set day for the when I actually record now. Now, I release shows most of the time on Sundays and Thursdays. But as far as when I record, I don't really have a set day anymore. I kind of got away from that, too. So I'll be doing more Thursday night shows now that football season's over and there's no Thursday night football. So if Thursday is a better day for you, Amanda, I'll definitely keep you in mind.
Yeah, yeah, that probably works a little better. But, you know, like I said, I'll try to, whenever it is, I'll try to just be mindful of it and see if I can get in and get, you know, get cool on a little earlier.
It's cool if you're late. Just if you need to consult with Eminem about being fashionably late, then you can do that. Even though Eminem's been on time a lot lately, it's been kind of scary that Eminem has been on time for the start of some shows.
I'll be outside with some barking dogs in the background so I can be on Eminem.
Right. You might know me now. So back in the day, I had to make that grand entrance, you know what I'm saying?
Man, Eminem would show up right before Final Thoughts, right? And he would call in, and you know, with Blog Talk Radio, I would have that, you know, the phone would pop up, and it would just say the phone number would be all ones, and I'm like, who is this calling? You know, phone numbers all ones, and it'd be Eminem from some remote location in the Appalachian Mountains or something. I don't know where he was calling from, but it was always funny because a lot of times he would call in late, and I kind of knew in the back of my mind it was him. But I wasn't sure because I didn't recognize the number. It was always some crazy looking number and stuff. And but man, what about the prank calls, man? Do you remember when we used to get a ton of prank calls back in the day? You know, white guys want to call in and try to insult us and all that stuff, and then Ray and Eminem and you would go off on them.
Oh yeah, man, it was crazy. We used to get some prank calls coming in, and you know, this show has been so much fun. Because it, you know, when this show came about, like I said earlier, it was a time when I was going through some things, but it's made, you know, the friendships that we formed over the years, and it's just been so much fun. And just I know when the hiatus was on, I'd actually talked to Crystal a couple of times. I'm going like, man, I wish Q would bring the show back. And I had been talking to you about it. I'm like, you need to bring it back. And you're like, no, man, I can't do it. I'm going like, why not? I said, this show, I mean, so many people listen to us way more than what we actually realize. And, you know, the prank calls were fun, but there were more listeners listening to us because we come in from so many different backgrounds. And people learn from that. And I'm going like, those people need us. You know, they may not be able to listen to us live, but I'm going like, they need us because all of us have come from different backgrounds and going through different things. And this is a platform where we can all bring it together and put it out there. Somebody may be going through that and they don't know where to turn. And they just happen to turn this podcast on. They're going like, you know what? I'm going through that same shit right there. And they may find a solution to that problem. And that's what makes this show so great. And I'm glad it's back.
All right, that's what's up. And all right, so before we get ready to kind of wrap things up, I do want to play a clip. It's part of an advertisement, so I got to scroll through the advertisement and see if I can find my way to the actual clip. But just give you all something to laugh at. So let me see if I can get it loaded here. Give me just a moment, then I got to fast forward through some things.
I'm Michelle of Resume.
My podcast on all major listening platforms like iHeartRadio, Spotify, Google Podcasts, and Apple Podcasts. You can also follow me on Instagram at @E_class100. Now enjoy the show.
Mother, if I go out and bang, you know, back in my day, if I went out and got some money and, you know, got famous, whatever, I banged 1,000 chicks. And the next day, I said I'm going, you know, a one-woman man, it's all cool. You let your daughter go out and get gang-banged or whatever, and she can turn around and be she can go to a convent, become a nun. That's going to stick with your ass the rest of your life. So I teach my daughter that it's a difference between a man and a woman. And, you know, I don't know why the world don't want to accept it. It's a difference. I don't make the rules, but I'm saying you can let your kids do that if you want to. When I'm in tears, they don't do exactly what you say. Don't get me wrong, but if you don't define the consequences, I'm telling you, you're going to be in a mess.
All right, Eminem, do you even remember saying that, man?
You know what? I do, but I didn't have a clue how long ago it was. Wow, man, that was a flashback for real, because that was the first time I said it. Damn. Wow.
Oh, man.
Man, I actually sound a little younger for some reason.
Man, let me tell you, and did you hear everybody laughing in the background? It's like, and that's what I missed. When I was off for 2 years and I really started thinking about what was important about the show, and like Crystal said, it was the camaraderie or whatever, man, everybody was cracking up. Because, I mean, anybody who had listened to the show long enough, of course, knew that was Eminem being Eminem. And, of course, we knew that. And it was so funny because even though with Eminem, when he hits on a point, you know he believes it 100%. But the delivery is always hilarious. And it can be something that you can agree with 100% or maybe you disagree with it 100%. You still going to crack up laughing at it. You know, it's just, and I mean, is that what you were referring to, Crystal, when you talk about the whole family aspect of it, the fact that we can enjoy each other and regardless if we agree or disagree, we usually can get back and do it again the next week? Crystal.
Oh, my God. I knew you would come to me when I stopped and went over to the other side of the room. what were you saying? The camaraderie, you can get back together.
See, and that's just, yeah, I'm basically saying that what you meant as far as, you know, how we were all just laughing at what Eminem was saying. And it's like, even though we're making our points and we're speaking our truth, we still have a good time doing it. And it's something that we look forward to every week. And that's what, that's definitely what I missed over the hiatus.
Oh yeah, absolutely. I mean, we, it was interesting how we were able to, I mean, I may have fumed, you know, on mute and whatever, when after a heated debate, and then afterwards I, you know, may have continued to fume and I probably, you know, IM'd you and was like, what the fuck? What's happening? And, you know, and all that. But yeah, I was back on the phone the next week because by then, you know, Gemini mind, we don't care. We forget about that shit. We're like, oh, what's up? And, but no, we, you know, it's all love. I really, you know, and it was fun and it was, you know, exciting and interesting to mix it up with different people. And actually a lot of the times when Amanda came in and, you know, even Robin, when she came in, you know, they would say things that were so like logical and practical and just made sense. And I was like,
the voice of reason.
Yeah, you're right. And so, you know, I would calm down and like, I know. And I'd be okay. So, but no, I think it was a lot of fun for everybody. And that's why we show back up. If we didn't like it, we wouldn't call in again. Why would we call in again to get more abuse? You know, I mean, I'm a sucker for, you know, gluttony for punishment, but most people aren't. And so, yeah, I mean, I think people tune back in because they love the back and forth, the camaraderie, the debate. I love debating. And so that's why I tune back in. So,
definitely. Yeah, me too.
And well, Ray, that's why I was, you know, she mentioned Amanda. And Ray, you and Amanda, I mean, being a married couple and living in the same house, sometimes you all would disagree on a topic, you know, on the show. And I've always wondered, and I'm pretty sure the other legends have wondered as well, were there ever any discussions after the show about some of the things you may have disagreed on? Right?
I say, yeah, I was on mute. I say, yeah, all the time. I mean, we would talk about different subjects and, you know, different things that I've said. I mean, she know how I am. She know my heart and everything else. But a lot of times she would think I go too hard on the females. I say something kind of out of the way, even though I may be right. You know, and, you know, it's always a situation of, she gave me an example one time. She said, you know, how would you feel if you had your favorite food that you like, but somebody served it on top of a garbage can lid? And I was like, well, you know, you wouldn't want to eat it like that.
Who's a garbage can lid, Ray? Okay.
No, you wouldn't want to eat it like that, although it's your favorite food. So certain things that I say, I can put a better twist on it.
That is a great analogy. I can't wait to steal that.
And then just come out and, you know, say what I was really thinking. I mean, it's just to talk the cue in me that, you know, you can really say what you want to say and stuff like that.
Right.
I mean, it's a much better way I can say it. It's a much more diplomatic way I can say it. And it's kind of like, you know, it's a nicer way to say it. See, one thing that Crystal did was she opened the door by saying things her way to allow me to say things my way. As far as, okay, you know, some women, if you go hard on them, they gonna, you know, they gonna back up a little bit, or they might say something to you like, Princess, the girl from Virginia, whatever. She
Virginia Princess, yeah.
Yeah, she never called back in. But never. I mean, you know,
and deleted her Facebook account.
She's like Clarissa Shields, man. You hit her, she's gonna keep coming back, gonna keep coming back for some more. So, I mean, it wasn't personal, we just giving our opinion and having fun with it. But I know at times it was better ways I could have said things, or I look back on it and say, well, as over the years you get older, more mature, not that I disagree with the points that I made. I just could have said it a different way. But yeah, we definitely talk about things at the house and, you know, just like, oh man, you know, you really said that, or this and that, or, you know, she know I'm, well, I ain't gonna say she don't know I'm not sexist. I might be considered that way.
But it's
not that way. It may be considered to be that way. I just tell the truth for what it is. It's just a lot of people don't want to hear it come out that way. And a lot of times I kind of backtrack on things. Like a few weeks ago, I forgot who we was talking to. We was talking to a set of, I forgot, it was some ladies on the show or something. And I made a reference to females that went to black universities. I didn't realize she was sitting there. She went to the black university. I didn't mean it that way. But
right,
that's how it was taken. So, you know, some things, yeah, we do get into it about it. But we don't never get into big disagreements, because she know how I am. And, you know, I'm going to say what I think. And, you know, she respect that. And I respect her. We love each other. So it's all good.
And Amanda, what was it like for you, though? Because, I mean, many times Crystal said that you should be canonized and made a saint.
Canonized? Saint Mary? God damn!
Ray would say something, and he would be the only person in the room saying it, but he stood tall and everything. So how did you feel knowing that everybody in the room would disagree with him, but he didn't care?
I mean, he's just being him, you know, and I just... It really depended on what it was, because in most cases, I know kind of where he's coming from. So I would just try to let him slide. But sometimes I had to say something, like afterward, we'd just say, hey, you know, and, you know, of course, when we get off the phone, it's like we're looking at each other. Or sometimes we would be in separate rooms and then we come together afterward. And, you know, we have a discussion about it.
You like, want to cut his damn throat out.
listen.
Like, what the hell?
And I can't take credit for the garbage can garbage can lid, that came from the Cosby Show. But
Oh, okay.
Yeah, but yeah, I mean, like, and that's what I was telling him, and I've told him that even outside of the show, like with family or whatever, like you can't just bark orders at somebody or just because you're right, it's about the delivery. So I'm constantly trying to remind him of that, but we've never had like a major falling out. I think probably the most heated would have been some of the political shows this past political season. So, but we, you know, we're always good and we always work it out. So, but I'm definitely making faces when he says certain things for sure.
If I had to vote again, I would change my vote. I would vote for Biden, y'all.
Oh man!
Dang. All right,
wow. Breaking news. That's huge. I think I need to get a squeeze on that.
And actually, there were many times I agreed with Ray, but
yeah,
the way he actually said it, I was like, "Oh hell no, we're all gonna die up in this motherfucker!" Damn, what did you just say? You know, he took me to those Saturday nights killing motherfucking shit. It's like, what the hell did you just say to me, nigga? I don't give a fuck.
Yeah, there were times where I was glad that we weren't in the room together.
And I respected him because I still respect him because I did agree with a lot of the things that he was saying. It was the delivery.
You know what's funny?
It just put me in my mode, so.
The funny part is when you say you agree with him, because I'm going like, I want to see her face when she says that, because I don't believe it. You know, because it's hilarious when you say you believe him. I'm going like, all right, I need to write this shit down in the calendar.
Oh, man. But I used to wonder, I said, Lord, I said, if I ever see Ray and Amanda on divorce court and Judge Lynn Toler, and she asks, why are you in the court today? And they say, well, we listen to this podcast called the Talk to Q Radio. So I'd be like, oh, Lord. That was my worst nightmare to be a part of that. But all right, so... just real quick, when I think about some of the people who joined the show back in the day, to see if you all remember, and I know Eminem remembers Fred. Fred was, where was Fred from?
Oh, yeah. He was from California. He's like,
Yeah. He was from NoCal, from Northern California.
Yeah.
Fred, there was Salahuddin. Salahuddin was out of New York City. He was a Muslim brother that used to call the show. Let's see, Vanity Strokes up in Toronto used to join the sex shows. And do you remember Laura? Laura used to call in the first 20 episodes.
Yeah, I remember.
Yeah, Laura. And Laura, falling out.
She lived here, I think.
Yeah, she's in Jackson. We had a falling out over, we were talking about people in jail getting too much preferential treatment, that it was too nice in jail. And, me and her had a falling out about that because I was like, you know, prison, it'd be prisoners. I didn't know at the time. I guess she had a dude locked up or something. And so I'm going in on how life is in prison. And she stopped calling the show. I mean, we're still Facebook friends. I've had conversations with her back and forth, you know, across the years. But she stopped calling the show. And like I said, mentioned earlier, my cousin Worm used to call in. JR the Boss Man. Anybody remember him out of Nashville, I think?
Yeah.
JR the Boss Man.
Yeah. Everybody know Boss Man.
Mm-hmm. Miss Vixen out of New York City. Coach Stephanie. Coach Steph was out of Houston. She was one of the first relationship coaches I ever met. And I actually stumbled across her. Say what now?
I said she got mad about something. I can't remember how it went.
And I actually came across her about 2 or 3 months ago, and she wants to get back on the show. So, I lost touch with her. And, I mean, there was Ben Diane, the Haitian hottie out of Florida. Did a show on immigration.
They used to call all the time.
Who?
Archie and Masibi. They used to call all
yeah,
the time.
Yeah. Yeah. Archie and Mashavia. Yeah, they just had a kid last year. So they got a little girl. And let's see, the crazy one out of Baltimore. Mary LaBelle. Actually, Mary LaBelle, yeah. I talked to her the other day. Her and Susie, the single dating diva, are going to do a show with me in the upcoming future. Jaha Knight out of South Carolina. Of course, Pianki, Mr. Solution. Mr. Solution. I used to think Pianki and Mr. Solution were the same person.
No, they were
anybody ever thought that?
The same night, though. But I love Solution, though. This dude actually called me ignorant. I said, boy, I said, you got to do a special with me and him go one-on-one. I'm going to show him my understanding of the dictionary. But it's all good.
Like. Yeah, and let's see, Miss Boom Boom. She was a trip.
Yeah, Jewels. Remember
Jewels?
Jewels, I think.
Yeah, Jewels. And the Sarita out of California. You talk about the Wu-Tang Clan.
Yeah.
And Coach Shante out of Toronto. True Speech.
Yeah, I forgot about Coach Shante.
Yeah. Y'all remember Latasha Lee? She was the mistress. Yep. Shaquille O'Neal's mistress in Atlanta. Yep. She came on and apologized to Shawnee O'Neal and... And,
oh man, I don't remember that. Goodness gracious.
Have
Melanie Biddles used to come on all the time, and
Melanie, she's still York doing City. Her thing. And Eminem, Beans, I know you ain't forgot Bethany Beans, the porn star.
Right. Yeah.
Half Russian, half Nigerian. I know you haven't forgotten about her.
Yeah. Well.
And Eminem, do you remember a guy named Scott? He called in from the ATL and y'all got into an argument about spanking kids or something?
About spanking kids, yeah.
Yeah.
Damn, I had forgotten.
Oh, man,
name.
Y'all but got yeah, it. Yeah, too, yeah. Too.
And he's a white boy, because I call white people niggas sometimes. Yeah.
Yeah. And Crystal, do you remember I brought an author on the show named Willie Spite? And he had a book about essentially about white girls being better than black girls or something. Do you remember him?
I don't remember him, but I'm sure that was a topic I was very interested in.
I remember you had a problem with him, and I read his book. His book was god awful. That was the worst book I think I've ever read in my life.
Duh.
It was the first chapter was really good. It set everything up. The last part of the book was garbage. I mean, it was just straight garbage. It just didn't have any direction. The plot was dumb. There was no transition. He even had one page in the book that was a completely different font than the other pages.
Oh,
so
Lord.
I'm like, how did that even happen? You didn't even have an editor? So,
no.
Yeah, that was a horrible book.
That sounds like
people got to highlight and right click that shit, man, and put it on the same font. Hey, what are them young girls, man? Damn, they was out of sight.
Which one? The Parker sisters?
I think they used to halfway listen to some of the stuff I was saying, man.
Yeah, that
I
was
Brittany
and Erica Parker. They were out of Louisville, Kentucky.
Louisville, that's right.
Yeah, and they used to call in all the time because they used to try to get advice from you guys. So they really loved listening to the show. And you had Clean Classy out of Atlanta. My man D. Wright from the Green Chump Show used to do the draft shows with it. You remember how we used to go hard on the draft?
Yeah. Right. And see, I remember we did like a dual show like two times or something with him.
Yeah. Yeah. We would do the Green Chump Show and do the NFL draft on his show, simulcast, for like 3 hours. And then we'd jump on my show and do like another 3 hours. Yeah. We'd be on the air for like six hours doing that.
Boy, everybody thought we was dry.
Yep. Dr. Aaron Anderson, Lauren Dahl. Lady T, the late Carmen Hendricks used to join the show. Arcadia Dario, the esthetician. Sonia out of California. Man, I can go on and on.
Yeah, Sonia used to call in quite a bit at one time.
Yeah, and Sweta Patel.
She
was a motivational speaker, a lady of Indian descent. She was really cool. Yeah.
And went to them. I thought they were some Puerto Rican chicks or something. They were actresses.
Man, what were their names? Yesenia Bailey was one, and I can't remember her friend's name, but they were out of New York. But Yesenia was trying to get on Saturday Night Live.
Right.
Yeah, Yesenia was hilarious. She had a YouTube show that was super funny.
Then I think when
Cherry Johnson was on there. That's when we didn't know Angle was a big fan of Cherry Johnson.
Yeah, yeah.
From Punky Brewster.
Yeah. We had Cherry Johnson on. And that was actually another show we called in, but we called into I don't know whose show that was. We spoke to Lisa.
Yeah.
Oh, that was your senior show.
I believe.
Yeah. We called in and talked to Lisa.
Yeah.
Speaking of classic, what was little girl name out of Memphis? And when I was telling her, she was like a sports counselor, and I was saying, man. I wish you could find that clip. I was trying to tell her there ain't no therapy for no man. That's what but drinking and pussy for. But she didn't like that.
That was Brittany J. Flynn.
Yeah.
Brittany J. Flynn.
Yeah, she's still around. She's still around doing her thing. Still counseling, too.
Yeah. Tell her I said my shit still better than her shit.
Damn.
Oh man. So, well, look, let's get ready to wrap things up and do some final thoughts, I guess. I got to step and grab some water. So, we'll do some final thoughts and wrap this thing up. And Crystal, I'll go with you first. Crystal?
Okay. Yes, I'm here. I'm sorry. Well, just like I said before, this was really good. Congratulations on your 10-year anniversary. And again, I feel honored. And thank you for continually inviting me to be a part of your show. It's a great show for our legends. It's a great show for people who call in, the interviewers. And it's just, you've done so well over the last 10 years and you, like I said, you've been consistent and you just keep going. And that's, you know, that's all you can do. I mean, you know, you're already an immortal in the world because, you know, even when you die, your stuff will still be out there and people will still be talking about you and your show. Oh yeah. We'll talk about you, you know, I'll talk about you. Good or bad, you know, we're going to say some shit. But, you know, I think it was a great time, and I look forward to the future. And I'm very, like I said, very grateful to be a part of this group, a very distinguished and, you know, excellent group of people who have, you know, been loyal to you and to the show and to each other. So I do feel, like Amanda said, that we are, you know, a family. And we've all been through a lot. And once we hear things about each other, I think we really are like, tell me more. Make sure to let me know what's going on so we can be there to support each other. So that's good. So thank you so much, Q. Thank you so much, you know, Eminem, Buck, Amanda, Ray, and, you know, people who are not on the show who are legends. Thank you so much for being a part of my life for the last 10 years, and I'm very grateful for that. So thank you. Look forward to the future.
And thank you, ma'am. It's always been appreciated your contributions to the show, and I can truly say that you're more than just a show legend to me. You're one of my friends, and I love me some Crystal.
Oh, yeah. I love you too.
All right, Ray, I'll go to you, man. Your final thoughts.
Congratulations on 10 years. I mean, time really flies by. I mean, we had a lot of shows. It's slow and it's long at the same time. And like you say, a lot of things that went on over the years. And, you know, it's been a great outlet. And, you know, Q fills a void, allows us to say what we want to say and a lot discuss the topics that we want to discuss. And a lot of times our voices are not heard, but we can hear our voices talking to each other and get each other's perspective on everything through intelligent opinions, through funny opinions, through all types of opinions that, you know, that we give, some of them that we think that we stand behind 100%. Some of them may have a different perspective on today than what we had 10 years ago or 5 years ago, but at the same time, we had the outlet to get it out. I appreciate talking to everybody because, you know, like you say, we family, we friends, and, you know, we just had a ball over these last 10 years. And I mean, I like to, you know, just keep it going because it's a great outlet. Now you see a lot of people since the pandemic, they start building all these podcasts with rappers and actors and entertainers and this and that. But I mean, this podcast right here may have gave some of these people these ideas. You never do know. A lot of people think because something is bigger than what they got the original idea, that they can't get the idea from how it was done here. So, I mean, it's all good, but, you know, I appreciate the sports shows. I appreciate the political shows, the controversial shows, and just being able to have the outlet to talk to everybody. And, you know, like I say, you know, it's always put there that, you know, me and Crystal had a lot of arguments, and we did. You know, it was fun. You know, I like to debate just like she likes to debate. But, you know, I know she's an intelligent woman. I know she's a smart woman. And, you know, I know she stands behind what she's thinking. You got to respect somebody like that. And I respect everybody on. And I appreciate all the times we had. So, congratulations on 10 years, man.
Thank you very much, man.
For all of us. Yeah.
Yeah.
Thanks, yeah, Ray.
And you mentioned, you know, all the competition out there. Yeah, there are a lot of people who are doing podcasts now, a lot of celebrities and putting a lot of money behind it. And it kind of pushes the quote unquote mom and pop podcast like mine kind of down on the list a little bit. But it's all good because I kind of have my niche, you know, I have my little cult following and I'm proud of that. And whether you guys know it or not, there are people all over the world who know who you are. And that's the tripped out thing about it. That's something Eminem used to always mention all the time. It's like, not only, you know, Eminem and I used to talk about this stuff and it never went any further than our office. We used to work the 2 to 11 shift and we used to talk about things that never left the office. But now some of those same conversations have been all over the world. And people have discussed it. I have a huge following in India right now. I don't know why, but I've been booming in India as of late, you know, and so that's cool. And so I think that's one of the great parts of the show is that we're worldwide on this thing. And so, Amanda, I'll go to you, ma'am.
It's, you know, it's always a pleasure to be involved and, you know, congratulations on 10 years. I'm thankful for you following a passion that you had and that you still have. You know, so many of us or so many people can kind of think of something and say, well, maybe, but you actually followed through on it and look where you are now. You know, it says a lot for you. It says a lot for your supporters. So, you know, kudos to you for making this all happen. You know, it's again, something that we all look forward to and we enjoy each other. And, you know, again, I'm thankful for each and every one of you. I'm thankful for the friendships we formed through the show. I know that if I need any of you, I can reach out to you guys. So, you know, that's a type of thing that you can know somebody your whole life and not have that type of relationship. So I think that says a lot about what we formed here and looking forward to the next 10 years.
Well, that's a lot of pressure. Thanks very much. Yeah, because I wonder now, it's like as far as how long do I want to continue? And I don't know. I'm kind of like Peyton Manning. I guess I'll continue until I can't throw it no more. You know, when I can't do it, maybe that's when I'll stop.
But, okay.
I'm really.
That sounds kind of weird.
I was going to say that can be taken so many ways. But yeah, so I mean, I just keep going and keep having fun. And I'm trying to like, you know, I do have like a lot of other people who want to be on the show now. And so I try to incorporate them with my show legends, but there are going to be times where I just want to have my show legends on, you know? And so I want to make a point, maybe, you know, at least once a month to try to have like a show legends only type of show, to get back to grassroots a little bit. So I'm going to work on that. But I have some new people, you know, who are very helpful as far as spreading the show and things of that nature. I mean, it might even be a new show legend coming in at some point before the year is out. Who knows, you know, but there's some people who are really helpful on the back end and behind the scenes who really embrace the show. So, but Amanda, yeah, I appreciate you. I know you mentioned that Sam Cooke picture back in the background back there.
Oh, yeah.
So I have to hold on, me blow it up so everybody can see it. Let me see if I can blow it up there. Yeah, that's Sam Ooh. Cooke back there. He was on the Ed Sullivan show. So,
yeah, Ray is just being a hater.
Yeah, I know. You can't hate on a classy man.
Nah.
Right. So, all right, Buck, what you got, man?
Man, it's been congratulations on the 10 years. You know, we kind of dabbled in this stuff for a long time, kind of talking about it, messing around with it and stuff like that. And then, you know, you finally brought it, you know, brought it to fruition. It's been pretty cool to be a part of this ride. I mean, and bringing the people that, bring the people together, you know, with, from Ray, Eminem, Crystal. It's just awesome, you know, because it does feel like family. I mean, it's family. We get to talk, you know, sometimes we talk every once in a while, you know, outside of the show. And it's just, it's amazing the friendship and the bond that we've managed to, you know, make during this 10-year run. I mean, it's just been nothing short of amazing. And the topics that we talk about, nobody else really wants to even touch. Or if they do touch them, they don't touch them the quite the right way.
It so sure
it's really fun to be a part of this. It's educational to be part of this. And we get to spit it the way we want to spit it. You know, if we want to say a curse word, great. We don't, we don't. If we're passionate about it, great. If we're not so passionate, it's all right too. Everybody gets to learn something from this. And that's what, like I said earlier, this is what makes the show great. But probably what makes the show even greater than that, other than being just worldwide and being listened to that way, it's just that the friendships and the bonds that we've made amongst ourselves, you know, these original show legends here, that's what really makes this really good. I mean, so when we say something, talk about something and put it out there, man, it just, all of us say it with our own way. You know, I'm kind of that one that kind of stays in the middle, so to speak, because I can see both sides. Yeah, I guess that's my niche. You know, I can see both sides, but you know, that's cool. I mean, everybody got their own way of doing things. So it's really fun. Looking forward to several more years. I'm going to make sure I keep the heat on you. So you make sure you keep going. That's what I do. But it's fun, man. And like I said, the friendships that we formed throughout this probably means more than just the show itself. I mean, because it's really fun. Yeah. And being able to, you know, contact each other when things go, you know, outside of the show, that's been fun too. So looking forward to many more.
Definitely. And, you know, the group that we have has always been a good mix, I would say, with, I mean, when you look at the personalities that we have, it just came together nicely. You know, it came to Buck is always the balanced one. He's going to see both sides of it. And Eminem is going to say the same thing he said 10 years ago today. Eminem's going to be consistent. I always called Amanda the voice of reason, and Ray and Crystal bring the passion, but from different perspectives. And so it just always seemed like it was the perfect mix. And I think that's what worked for all of us. So Eminem, shut it down, man. The original show legend, the Minister of Sexual Affairs.
Oh,
from a pimp's perspective.
Man. Oh, man.
I don't have
oh, boy. Oh, man. Oh, man. You got to play me some clips with some of that shit.
Here it comes.
Man, the sands of time, baby. The sands of time. You know what I'm saying? You know what I'm saying? The hardest substance on God's green earth is the motherfucking diamond. So 10 years is what you get for 10 years, a diamond, baby. So a diamond is forever. So you know what I'm saying? You have forever cemented us, including me. You know what I'm saying? That's why, that's where the loyalty comes from. You know what I'm saying? Like, man, just giving all us this platform and giving us this platform with no restraint. You know, so, you know, everybody know me, know I'm an artist and stuff, and artists do not like to be contained. And so, you know, what this show has done, it helped a lot of people. First and foremost, that's what it is. It helps a lot of people, you know. And a lot of people have very poignant things they say to help people, you know, in their own special way. Buck is real good at that, you know. One thing he says all the time is communication is the key, you know. And I agree with that, but I don't like saying shit like that, you know what I'm saying? But that's what this show brings, you know. It allows Q to just kind of sit back and just not have to, you know, some talk shows, it be so one-sided that the damn host got to clean it up. But with us, you get so many different views that pretty much you don't really have to do nothing but just sit back and just say everybody go at it. You know what I'm saying? So, you know, that's what I like about this. Nah, fuck that. That's what I love about this. You know, that freedom of expression. You know what I'm saying? And then, you know, everybody got their own way to, like, you know, with some of the tragedies over the last, you know, 2020, that came to the forefront. A lot of people trying to now promote black business and stuff like that. Man, what the fuck thing you been doing? You've been promoting black business since we started this show. You know, it ain't just for black people, but I'm saying, I guarantee you, I don't change my personality for nobody, but the shit that Q allowed me to do and the way he allowed me to get this fucking free advertisement and, you know, and help other people share the good news about myself in the form of life, you know, and all of that, man, I can't get that shit nowhere else. You know what I'm saying? So, you know, shout out to Q for that. And, you know, shout out to all the legends on here for number one consistently calling. You know, and definitely with the females involved, you know what I'm saying? Because a lot of times when a show clearly doesn't have men that you have to question which bathroom they go in. You know, a lot of times, a lot of women, you know, they're like, oh, this show too strong for me. I can't deal with this shit. But you know what I'm saying? So shout out to the, you know, the, of course, Crystal, Amanda, and, you know, any other ladies they called in over the years, you know, kind of consistently, you know what I'm saying? So that's a great thing, you know what I'm saying? And like I say, it allowed for this format, and, you know, words can't express, you know what I'm saying? If you see my avatar, man, I made that shit, man. I took that stuff off of it. It ain't a real avatar. I just made it. But, you know what I'm saying? I got that Midnight Eagle green on, but you see them two M's on that bitch, don't you? 13-13, you know what that shit means? Free, unadulterated, legalized opportunities to self-merchandise your property that you was blessed with. Yes, I said that. And Q gave me the platform to say that. You know, this shit unscripted, baby. You know what I'm saying? You getting the real deal with every one of all five of us on here now. And I done had a lot of this shit while I'm drinking. Hold on. Damn.
What
but,
did you get for $10?
Anything you want.
Anything?
Anything.
So, I'm gonna have to get that clip uploaded on here some kind of way.
Yeah, man. You know, and like I say, QQ exposed a lot of people to a lot of cultures and stuff. See, a lot of people didn't know how many subcultures was actually in black culture. I'm not just saying, you know, every culture got subcultures, but think about it. You know, this show helped show people what the beauty of the African American world looked like. You got off the chain thinking African Americans, you got intelligent African Americans, you got even keel, you got before this show, there's a lot of black people didn't know black people didn't like NASCAR until they met Buck. You know, when you think of black artists, you think of people just strictly drawing black shit, you know, not no abstract stuff. So I'm saying, Q gave us that platform, you see what I'm saying?
You know, he gave us that platform. Even with politics, you know, you got an array of opinions. Everything ain't just all one damn thing. You know what I'm saying? So this show has done so much to uplift. You know, now I can put words in Q's mouth because I know him like that. His show is for everybody. But what I'm saying, but indirectly, he really, really had made a strong statement to the world of how they should view Black people. You know what I'm saying? Especially in America, we got all kind of different thoughts and opinions. The only thing we share is pigmentation. But we are individualized. And I think if this show don't demonstrate individualism, I don't know what does. You know what I'm saying? So, 10 years, hang in there, you know, looking for 10 more and beyond, you know what I'm saying? But like I said, that diamond is forever. So, you know, if a bomb dropped on this motherfucker, they dug it up, you know, 50,000 quadruple years from now, and they had some kind of apparatus that could play something. And they like, hey, you know, what was it like in America with certain cultures or whatever? All they got to do is listen to 910 damn episodes, maybe 911 episodes. You know what I'm saying?
912,
damn. You get a full apex of this shit, man. You know what I'm saying? So that's some real flavor in your ear. You know what I'm saying? So, yeah. So congratulations, Q, man. Keep this thing rolling, baby. Keep it rolling. You know, I kind of missed that very first night. I finally forgot that first number you had with the LA prefix. I finally forgot that
one. Yeah, I can't remember it either, man.
But I remember that shit in my head for a long time, you know. But, you know what I'm saying? But, yeah, man. You know, this is a great show, great guest. People call in stuff, but these young people got to start calling in, man. We got to pass this knowledge on, man. You know, I want to be around this motherfucker for, you know, 50 more years at least, but shit, man, we got to have somebody pass the torch to you, then. These folks ain't calling in. You know what I'm saying? They ain't calling scared shit, man. No, you have to call in. Tell us what you think. You know, shit.
I hear you, man. Mm-hmm. And but that's the beauty of getting Eminem on a Saturday night. You get Eminem with the Hennessy. Oh man, but yes, yeah, so I appreciate that, and I want to thank you all because this show, it really means a lot to me because it's kind of, you know, my legacy along with my blog, and you all are a part of that. Like Eminem said, somebody digs up a time capsule 25 years from now, they're gonna hear what we were complaining about, you know, back in 2020 and you know and beyond. And I don't know, it's funny because this show. You know, I know someone mentioned earlier it's therapeutic. It was therapeutic for me, too, because even though I don't always voice my opinions, I mean, I do sometimes. I don't always voice my opinions, but the topics, you know, were sometimes things that I may have been going through or knew someone who was going through that particular scenario. So I'd throw the topics out to get other people's opinion. And that would allow me to kind of, you know, form some type of a solution to whatever situation may have been going on at the time. And so the show was very therapeutic in that sense. Back in June 2012, I lost my mom. And then 5 months later, I lost my wife in November 2012. And the show kept me going, you know, because after I lost my wife, man, I was in like, I don't know, I've never felt so empty. You know, my mom and my wife were gone. And so I remember I went that December, a month after she passed away, I went down to Pensacola. I hung out with Buck, had a good time down there, kind of got myself together. And I had the show to keep my mind occupied, you know. And so I was probably, you know, doing 2-3 shows a week. And that kept my mind off of the sadness, you know, and allowed me to heal. It took me a while, but it allowed me to heal and kind of get back out there. And everything. So it's really meant a lot to me as well. And I just enjoy it, you know, what everyone brings to the table. And everyone has some sort of talent or gift that comes along with it. And like I said, you know, Crystal is an author, Eminem's an artist. And so you have those people, those type of minds, abstract minds coming to the table is always good. And man, Ray is one of the most knowledgeable sports people I know. I mean, you know, he's passionate about everything he discusses, but when it comes to sports, man, Ray really knows his sports. And I respect that big time, because you got some of the people who fake it, but it's nice to see somebody who actually knows what he's talking about. And then, of course, Amanda is just so logical. It's like when I'm asking her the questions, I can hear the gears turning in her head, you know, before she gives her speech or whatever, and her retort to whatever's being said. And so, you know, I have to thank all of you for what you've brought to the table as well, because this is your legacy too. And all the people that, you know, we've met along the way and everything, I mean, that's been great. Some relationships I have, you know, a lot of people that I've never met, but I still have these longstanding relationships with them because our paths crossed on the show. It's always been cool to me to see people who have been on my show go on to have their own shows. You know, at one time, Milani and True Speech had their own show. You know, and if I can think, I can't really think, but off the top of my head, there might have been five or six people who were guests on my show who went on to do their own thing or collaborate together and do their own thing. Susie, the single dating diva, and Mary LaBelle had their own show, and you know, and that was pretty cool. And so it was always nice to bring people together, allow them to network and go out and do, you know, greater things. And so I'll go ahead and get ready to wrap this up. And I just want to thank you all for being there. And I look forward to, like someone said, another 10 years. I mean, I ain't got nothing else to do. So we'll keep this thing going. We'll get into, like I said, back on, you know, more relationship topics, because there are a ton of things out there going on. There are a ton of things to talk about. And, you know, I see your little private message, Eminem, about the blog. I appreciate that. And I mean, there are a ton of things to talk about. And so we'll get back into it. So I'll be reaching out to you. Things are a little different. There's not a call-in number now. I have to send you an invite. But you'll be hearing from me. And so I look forward to more great shows in the future. So I thank you all very much. All right. So that's going to do it for tonight's show. Go to talktoq.com. Got a calendar there. You can check the show calendar, see what's coming up in the future. And we'll catch you all. Uh-oh, my dog's waking up. I hear him shuffling around back there. And we will catch you all next time. So I appreciate you. You've been listening to the Talk to Q Radio Show. No experts.